Welcome back to the Island 54 Devlog. Today, I'm going to try turning my voxels into hexagons. Last week, I worked on survival aspects of the game. Next, I want to start making the world bigger, but need to settle on the world's geometry first. I'll start by talking a bit about why I want to try using hexagons. Then I'll recap how my current voxel system works. I'll then explain how I converted my voxels to hexagons, and lastly, show you how it looks with a demo. As always, there are chapter marks and timestamps down in the description below. I've always been fascinated with games using hexagonal tiles for a couple of reasons. Firstly, they just have better geometry. A square grid has four undistorted directions, the cardinal directions. But try making something diagonal in a game like Minecraft, and the diagonal distortion becomes really obvious. You see the distortion again when you try approximating circles in square-based games. With hexagons, on the other hand, you get six undistorted axes. While you miss out on two of the cardinal directions, the diagonals turn out to have much less distortion, and even a small ring of hexagons does a pretty good job of approximating a circle. The second reason is that I've always wondered what a big world would be like if it were not just the size of a planet, but also the shape of a planet. Now, I realize you can't tile a sphere with regular hexagons, but you can get pretty close if you accept a little bit of distortion at just a few points on the sphere. This is another area I'd love to experiment with in the future. It might seem like building would be weird in a hex-based world, but I think this can be easily addressed by treating the building system separately to the voxel system and providing a range of snapping options. My current voxel system is covered in more detail in episode 3, but here's a quick recap. I treat the world as a single chunk. Within that chunk is a big array of voxel objects describing the blocks that make up the world. For now, they're either solid or air. Coordinates are broken up into a planar coordinate, being the X and Z parts, and a Y coordinate, being the altitude. The terrain generator just populates all the entries in the chunk's voxel array using Perlin noise. To render the terrain mesh, I look for solid voxels, then check each of its neighbours to see whether or not they are solid. Only faces bordering a non-solid block can even be seen by the player. There's then code to convert voxel coordinates to world coordinates so that we know where to draw a voxel's faces, and an index to tell us which voxel each part of the mesh is associated with. Last week, I learned a new word. This week, I'm going to make one up. I'm going to call my hexagonal voxels hoxels. To implement my hoxel system, I just had to code up a hexagonal geometry and port the existing algorithms over to it. Like anyone who works with hexagons, I started by absorbing everything over at Red Blob Games, where Amit Patel goes into a ton of detail about how to reference and store hexagons, and most of the maths you need to implement the basics. I chose to use a hybrid of cubic and axial coordinates. In this coordinate system, there are three axes, Q, R, and S. Each is 120 degrees with respect to the others. To move to a neighboring hexagon, you always just increment one value and decrement another. The sum of the components always adds up to zero, so I just store the Q and R components and generate the S component on the fly. I wrote code to convert to global coordinates and made some code to calculate movement along each of the hexagonal axes. Previously, the decision of which texture to apply to each face was made at render time based on the voxel's Y coordinate, and water was just represented by a static plane. I wanted to handle all this a bit better, so extended the Hoxel class to support multiple block types, including stone, sand, water, and grass. Rendering water as part of the main mesh generation pass turned out to be a mistake, since I use the same mesh for rendering as I do for terrain collisions, meaning the player was able to walk on water. So I factored out a bunch of common mesh generation code and generated the water in a second pass. That almost worked as expected, but apparently I needed some sort of a callback to allow each of the separate generators to customize their game objects. Next, I needed to update my scatter generator, which just picked rectilinear coordinates at random. You can't do that in a hexagonal chunk, because if the sum of the Q and R components gets too big, then the S component will overflow. So I put a hack in. It keeps picking random coordinates until it finds a valid one. It's a bit like using a six-sided die to generate a random number up to 5 by just discarding any rolls that come up as 6. I know there's a better way of doing this, and I'll clean it up next week when I implement some more advanced hexagonal geometry. My surface smoothing code, which is responsible for replacing small steps in the terrain with slopes, actually got drastically simplified, since hexagons that tile a plane only have adjacent neighbours, unlike squares, which have diagonal neighbours to consider too. Just before I get to the demo, I thought I'd point out Unity is running their spring sale over at the Asset Store, with 50% off hundreds of assets. While it's not the visual look I'm going for at the moment, I've always liked the look of nature manufacturers' assets, and might go off on a tangent sometime soon to see how my terrain would look if it were realistic instead of low poly. Many of their assets are 50 or even 70% off at the time of recording. There's an affiliate link down in the description below. So, are hexagons the bestagons? Yeah, I think so. The terrain looks better in my opinion, and I can see plenty of potential from a gameplay perspective from using a hexagonal plane. Next week, I'm planning to keep working on the Voxel system and get multiple chunks into my world, with a view to having chunk streaming working soon. I can tell that the mathematics is going to be a lot more complicated, since the chunks themselves are n-gons instead of hexagons, and have a different orientation to the Voxels themselves. There's a pretty good series of articles by Sander Evers over on ObservableHQ.com about how to arrange hexagons into a larger hexagonal grid, which seems exactly what I need. On to some housekeeping quickly. I've had a couple of people ask about setting up a Discord server for this community. I love the idea, but don't want to create a server that's DOA. So here's what I'm going to do. If we can get to 1,000 subscribers, I'll create one to celebrate the milestone. We're already over halfway there. As always, if you enjoyed this episode and want to support the series, please do leave a thumbs up. It really does help. And until next time, happy game developing.